teaching Catholics to graciously and persuasively engage those who disagree with him. Trent models that approach each week on the radio program Catholic Answers Live and on his own podcast, The Council of Trent. He has also been invited to debate at UC Berkeley, UC Santa Barbara, and Stanford University. Trent is an adjunct professor of apologetics at Holy Apostles College. He has written for the National Catholic Bioethics Quarterly and is the author of 9 books, including Answering Atheism, The Case for Catholicism, and Why We're Catholic, Our Reasons for Faith, Hope, and Love. Please join me in welcoming Trent Horn.
So much for being here. Man, this is super fun to be here this year as opposed to last year. Was anyone here last year? Okay, yeah, it was a totally different vibe. We didn't have as many people, there are masks, things were a lot more authoritarian. They're still authoritarian, but La Resistance is doing quite well. So I'm so glad you all are here. Just a few housekeeping details. Oh, and the other thing, the food spread is looking really nice, by the way. They did a really good job with that. 2 things I noticed. On the vegetable platter, they have what looks like a magical plant leaf. I'm still not daring enough to eat that. I'm worried it might turn me into something. But I mean, you got your standard stuff, little tomatoes, little celery, but the magical plant leaf, I'm like, what is that? And then you guys get to have the pirate booty. Like, they only have that, like, I'm a dad of 3 kids, so I only see pirate booty at, like, kids' birthday parties. And it's like, you can't eat the snacks that are for the 4-year-olds, at least not if you want to be polite. And so you always see them eat it, and it's like, they can't appreciate it. They can't appreciate these wonderful puffs. So it's great to see that you all are here. I want to start by sharing with you an experience that I had at Emory University. So a few weeks ago, I was invited to debate a pro-choice philosopher, Nathan Nobis. He teaches at Morehouse College, this is over in Atlanta. And Nathan is probably, I would say, one of the top 5 pro-choice philosophers in the country. So, and I've debated others. I debated David Boonin at Stanford, for example. Because what I believe is when there's something I care about, it could be something related to the Catholic faith, it could be a moral issue, something like pro-life, it could be the existence of God, the resurrection of Jesus. I always want to find out, okay, who defends the other side and who is the best person, who has the strongest case on the other side, and what's wrong with it? And then if I see that the best case doesn't succeed, I have more confidence in what I believe. I think that's what everybody should be doing. So I've been familiar with Nathan's arguments since probably about 2013, 2014, so I was really excited to take part in this debate. But I'll tell you, the hardest part in preparing for this debate was not researching Nathan's arguments, which are very good and they're comprehensive, and I actually enjoy reading thoughtful arguments from people, even people I passionately disagree with. Rather, the most difficult part in preparing for this debate was trying to get the debate to happen at all. Because what I found was interesting, and this made Nathan himself really angry, that one thing we both had in common was that pro-choice people just do not want to debate this issue. They absolutely refuse to do that. So the pro-life group at Emory was working very hard to try to put together an event, and they wanted it to be very fair. They tried to reach out to find a neutral moderator in the school's philosophy department, in bioethics. None of the professors wanted to offer to do that. They reached out to the pro-choice medical club, so the student organization for pro-choice medical students, because it was pro-life medical students who were putting on the event, and they have their pro-life group, and they reached out to the pro-choice club and said, do you want to co-sponsor this debate with us? That way it's equal, we're all involved, both sides are equally represented. They said, absolutely no, absolutely not. We don't want to promote it, we don't want to be involved in it in any way, shape, or form. And then Nathan himself personally reached out to the pro-choice club and he said, look, I think this is important. We need to debate this issue. We need to engage people. And they said, no, our policy is that abortion is something that that is not up for debate. It's not up for debate. And this is actually a piece of rhetoric that I've seen those on the left use. I actually did a podcast episode about this a few weeks ago. That those on the left, this is their new Hail Mary pass to defend their viewpoints, to defend the indefensible. They'll say, well, it's not up for debate. Maybe you've heard this. Maybe you heard this at your universities. Let's talk about transgender ideology. Trans lives aren't up for debate, they'll say. Have you ever heard that? They'll say, well, you can't debate trans people because obviously we exist. Well, of course, obviously there are people who identify as transgender or people who say transgender ideology is correct. But that doesn't mean that you're right. There are people who say the opposite. It doesn't mean that they're right. Rather, the university was once a place for the marketplace of ideas, for ideas to clash with one another and to see which ones have the best evidence for them, and those are the ones that should survive. But it's certainly not like that anymore. Now, this is true for pro-life. I've been to numerous university campuses where pro-choice organizations say they won't do debates. And I know exactly why. Because when they do debates, the ugly reality of what abortion is becomes plain for others to see, and they can't be saved by the host of the CNN show going to commercial or something like that. That's the other thing, by the way, that I think that what we should focus on as conservatives, pro-life advocates, as Christians, is to promote real debates. I'm talking about real formal debates or long-form dialogues to talk about important issues. That is something I think has really harmed public discourse in America today, is cable news debates. They're not even usually debates. Usually it's not even someone from the other side. And when it is the other side, it's highly scripted, it's controlled, and the network that's sponsoring it makes sure that their view is the one that comes out on top, whether it's the right or the left. That's why I was so jazzed to see Joe Rogan just sit down with Dr. Sanjay Gupta. Did you guys see that? It was several months ago. And suddenly it's like, oh, guess what? You can't just go to commercial when you're uncomfortable. You have to sit here and you have to be held accountable for things you or what your network has said. And that's why I love doing debates and dialogues on abortion. To say, all right, let's put out our arguments, let's test our arguments and see what happens. But then we finally got the debate together, even without the pro-choice student organization. It was widely advertised on Emory's campus. But by the time when I got there, there were probably about 40 people in attendance, and I would say 35 of them were from off campus. They were pro-life advocates, people who, members of the local Right to Life community. The Emory student population couldn't be bothered to come and hear something like this, because for them, it's not up for debate. Though we recorded the debate, and then we're going to put it on my YouTube channel here, I think on Monday, actually. So you can watch it, and you can share it. And I think it's a good way to show here is a very philosophical pro-life case and a very philosophical pro-choice case, because most pro-choice arguments are very emotional. They're emotional rhetoric, and Nathan is not like that. But when you watch it, you'll see where the pro-choice position falls apart. But in order to do that, we have to engage others, whether it's a formal debate, formal dialogue, or even informally, engaging in conversations with people on campus. But how do we do that? Sometimes when we talk about the issue of abortion, pro-life advocates kind of shoot themselves in the foot. And the reason for that is they talk about things that are irrelevant to the main issue. People will say, what about women who are in poverty? You're an uncaring pro-life Republican. You don't believe in these social programs that would actually help the poor. And we take the bait. And, we'll argue. And was it Andy Posner who spoke earlier? Yeah, I was listening to his talk. He gave great stuff. I mean, he had great points on how many of these, government programs, for example, are inefficient. And I used to work for the government, actually. And it was awesome. Because you don't have to compete against anybody, and you can kind of rest on your laurels, and it's super fun. And it's also super inefficient. And so there's a lot of merit to there. But then we start arguing about that, and suddenly we're not arguing about abortion anymore. And the conversation becomes not as helpful for other people. So what I want to give you is more of a framework that I use in my conversations when I talk about abortion, whether it's on the radio, even in public debates. I always follow this particular framework. And I find it helpful because it keeps the conversation focused on the one question that matters most. What are the unborn? That is, like, I know you're taking notes and things like that. You can draw bold circles around this. What are the unborn? That is the one question that matters most. How do I know that? Like I said, I have little children. I have a 7-year-old, a 5-year-old, and a 1-year-old. My 7-year-old, my wife just texted me. Kids have great quotes. My 7-year-old, 3 boys, by the way, so it's always an adventure. This morning, my son said to my wife, I want to build a booby trap. And she said, okay, let's look up a video to do that. And he said, no, we don't have to do that. I can use my mind. My mind is like a video, except it's all action. And I was like, that is just a really good quote. My mind is like a video, but it's all action. Like, it doesn't make sense, and it does make sense at the same time. And it's like, okay. So just imagine my 7-year-old, your 7-year-old, comes in behind you. Mommy or daddy, can I kill this? We hear this at the house. Not infrequently. What are you going to ask? Mommy or daddy, can I kill this? What is it? You're not going to say yes or no. Because if it's a cockroach, if it's a lizard, you'd say, all right, let's get the raid. Let's get a boot. Let's get a big rock. Let's get to work. If it's the neighbor's cat, people disagree. If something does not have a soul, if it's a soulless monster, no, I'm just kidding. I know cats are, some people find an affinity for them. Yeah. I, for one, welcome our new feline overlords. So cats just act like a roommate who's constantly annoyed with you. As if, anyways, so we're not sure. Normally, though, we'd say, no, we're not going to do that. And, you're washing the dishes, you're not paying attention. Mom or daddy, can I kill this? And you turn around, and he's got his 2-year-old sister, or in my case, his 5-year-old brother, in a headlock. Or an arm bar. They've been doing jujitsu for a few months. They like to, and now they do arm bars on each other to immobilize each other. Can I kill this? Well, not just no, but it's time to go to counseling, you little sociopath. But that's it. That's the issue. Because every honest person called in the that abortion kills something. The question is, what is it? If the unborn are not human beings, abortion needs no justification. Who cares? I mean, you might look down on somebody who gets 10 abortions like you wonder about somebody who gets 10 cavities, but it's not a moral atrocity. You might think, brush your teeth once in a while, buddy. But if you heard that someone had 10 abortions, it's not like 10 cavities. Well, why? If the unborn are not human beings, it doesn't matter. But if the unborn are human beings, then abortion cannot be justified. So that's what we need to focus on. But many times people don't focus on that. Consider this phrase. Abortion should be legal because... Abortion should be legal because... Fill in the blank. What do people say? Abortion should be legal because... Why? What do most people say? Shout it out. Rape, healthcare. Any others? Cluster of cells. Adoption. Maybe poverty, choice. It's a woman's right to choose. Notice that only a few of those dealt with the question, what are the unborn? Most of them are abortion should be legal because born people need abortion. It just sidesteps the question, what are the unborn? Completely sidesteps it. It says, well, what about choice or poverty or these other issues? So then what do we do when those issues are brought up that don't address what the unborn are? How do we get back to the unborn? I use a technique developed by my friend and colleague Scott Klusendorf called trot out a toddler. All right? It has 4 steps. All right? So these are the 4 steps. They each start with A, so it's easy to remember. First one is agree. Then apply, then ask why, and then ah. Agree, apply, ask why, ah. Let me show you how this works. I once did a debate at the University of California in Berkeley, and very tolerant, open-minded campus. So I go there. I think they set some trash cans on fire a year earlier when Ben Shapiro went to speak there. And then when I get there, nobody cares. I'm like, not even one small trash can is on fire. I was I was sad, but you know, all right. So I go in, and then, because that's how you know you're cool if you're a conservative people. Well, things, people set things on fire when you show up, you know. So then I go in, and I was debating Malcolm Potts. Malcolm Potts was one of the people who helped make abortion legal in England back in like the 1950s. So he's an embryologist, he teaches at Berkeley, and at the, back then at least, he was doing these debates at the end of the semester in his class. So he would debate, so I give him credit that he was willing to do that because most pro-choice people won't. And so he would do this, and I came in and we debated the issue. And during Q&A, one of the women in the back stood up and she said, "Mr. Horn, here's my question for you. What about a woman who lives in an impoverished country, a very poor country, and she's pregnant and she has two children, a four-year-old and a two-year-old, and she can barely feed her four-year-old and two-year-old. You know, they're at the risk of starvation. Shouldn't at least a woman like that be able to have an abortion? At least someone in that case." And now remember, it's easy to get sidetracked. It's easy to say, oh, well, we have foreign aid, there's foreign adoption, you know, all these other things. But here's the thing, even if there wasn't foreign aid, even if there wasn't international adoption, would abortion be moral in the absence of those things? No. So in order to help her see that, I said, well, let me ask you this. You said that she's pregnant, has a four-year-old and a two-year-old, doesn't know how to feed all these kids. What if she just killed the two-year-old? And then when the baby's born, it might be easier to feed a newborn than a two-year-old. Then she still has two kids and everything's all the same. Well, maybe she should do that instead. What do you think? And she said, well, you know, no, obviously you can't do that. I said, well, why not? Well, because it's a human being. You can't kill people. I said, okay. So that's the issue. So now I'm going to rewind it, and you'll see where I actually use this framework. So first is agree. So even before asking that question, I said, you know what? That's a tough situation. If I didn't know how to feed my kids, I'd be freaking out. I'd be really scared. That's hard. So the first step is agree. Why should we try to agree with people? Why do we agree with the other side? Because we don't want them to think of us as the other side. My friend Steve Wagner puts it this way. People won't care if the unborn are human unless they first see that you and I are human. Let me repeat that. People will not care if the unborn are human unless they see that you and I are human. That's the problem. If people just see us as a culture warrior, they'll just want to refute anything that we say. But if they see that, oh yeah, you're right about X, that is a good point. Oh, okay, I care about truth, not just about winning. So agree whenever possible. Then apply. You want to apply the argument to a two-year-old. Remember, if the unborn are as human as two-year-olds, we shouldn't kill them. But we need to get people to see that. So it always starts the same way. You say, imagine I have a two-year-old here, and you take whatever the pro-choice argument was, if it does not answer the question, what are the unborn? And you apply it to that two-year-old. In this case, it's poverty. And so I gave an example to her, why not just kill your two-year-old if you think you can't take care of all of your children? Agree, apply. What's the third step? Ask why. Say, why not kill the two-year-old? And she said, well, you know, you can't do that. Or to ask, should she be able to kill the two-year-old? No. Now, here it's tempting to want to be like, ah, see, if you don't believe it's okay to kill two-year-olds, why would you kill unborn children? We want people to come to that conclusion for themselves. So ask, look, I know this is kind of a dumb question, or it's like a crazy question, but just humor me. Why? Why can't she kill the two-year-old? And then some people will kind of be on to where we're going with the argument. They'll say, well, it's human, it's born, it's breathing, to which you can say, all right, then that's the issue. Ah, that's the issue. You don't want to actually do that. It's kind of pretentious. But you can say, okay, that's the issue. It's not about choice or poverty or equal rights or health care or any of these other reasons that don't answer the question, what are the unborn? It's about whether the unborn are as human as two-year-olds. If we don't kill two-year-olds because of someone's choice, because of poverty, because of overpopulation, then we shouldn't kill the unborn for the same reason. Well, they're not human. They're a fetus. Okay, that good. That's what I want to be talking about. What are the unborn? And now we're on the one question we need to talk about and not all these other irrelevant things. To give you another example, overpopulation. I once engaged someone on the radio. They called me and said, you know, I think the world's totally overpopulated and we need abortion. Now, I don't think the world's overpopulated. You probably don't. But I don't want too much on my plate to argue about. So what's the first step of the four A's? Agree. So how do we agree here if we don't really believe the world's overpopulated? Well, you could agree with something trivial, or you know, just agree with a secondary part. Like, I agree some parts of the world are very crowded. I agree there are some parts of the world where people lack access to basic resources. That's true, right? Even if the world's not overpopulated, there are these problems. I agree with that. Or you could agree for the sake of the argument. You could say, look, I don't think the world's overpopulated. But even if you were right, that wouldn't mean we should promote abortion. So let's just say you were right, for the sake of the argument, that the world is overpopulated. Then what do? Agree, what's the next step?
Apply.
Now you can do it the standard way. Imagine I have a 2-year-old here. Should we kill 2-year-olds to reduce overpopulation? No, of course not. What's the third step? Why not? Because it's a human being. Oh, okay, we don't kill human beings. The more you do trot out a toddler, the more you will be able to improvise. How many people here can play a musical instrument? Okay. How many people here can play the trumpet? Yeah, I thought so. When it came time in the 7th grade, they said, everyone, pick an instrument to learn. And I, with my dopey seventh grade brain, walked past the romantic and sexy guitars and picked the trumpet. Okay? But, you know, I wrote a love song for you. I think I can still do it, though. C, D, E, F, G, you know. But that's, it's just, it's hard to be a sexy instrument when you have to, empty a saliva valve. Common hazard in the brass instruments, okay? And on some of the reed instruments as well. But regardless, if you learn an instrument, right? When you learned an instrument, what was the first? You didn't just start, you picked it up, and you just did Spanish guitar by Carlos Santana, or you know, just you didn't start riffing away at it because you would have sounded terrible. Instead, you all started with this. Hot cross buns, see how there's something, da 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 da. Why? Because you have to learn the basics and get them down over and over again before you can start doing the interesting stuff and improvise. And that's similar with learning how to talk about important issues, whether it's pro-life, whether it's human sexuality. You start with the basics, like what I'm giving you here, trot out a toddler. Imagine I have a 2-year-old here. Would you kill a 2-year-old for choice, a 2-year-old for overpopulation? You get the basics, then you can improvise. Like with this guy, I said, look, all right, you think we need abortion to deal with overpopulation. Well, what if not enough women choose abortion? Do you think we should force women to have abortions if the world's overpopulated? So it's basically like trot out a toddler. I'm just picking another act of violence. Instead of the act of violence being killing a 2-year-old, the act of violence is forcing a woman to have an abortion, okay? I asked him, should we force women to have abortions if there's too many people? He said, well, no, you can't do that. I said, so agree, apply, what's the next step? That's why. Okay, well, why not? It's too many people, why not? They do that in some places. You know, starts with a cha, ends with ina. So, you know. Or it depends how you pronounce it. They do this over in China. Terrible, terrible things they would do there. They can't do anything right. They've got a great wall. Mine will be even greater. I always miss whoever's in office, you know, like doing the impersonation of them. Like, come on, man, are they doing that over there? You always have to have a calibrating phrase when you impersonate somebody. You know, for Bill Clinton, it's just sticking my thumb out gets me in that mode. I feel your pain. Once I put my thumb out like this, and I can talk like him. But to do Biden, it's always, come on, man. Come on. Agree, apply, ask why. Why not? Why not force people to have abortions? He said, well, because you can't violate people's rights, even if the world's overpopulated. I said, oh, Well, then by that logic, we shouldn't violate the rights of unborn children. If you wouldn't make someone have an abortion to reduce overpopulation, then you shouldn't force someone to be aborted for the same reason. And then the caller mysteriously dropped. But now we're at this point. Okay, well, what are the unborn? Well, they're just fetuses. They're not human. They're not persons. And here what we need to do is use science and philosophy. Science tells us what something is. Philosophy and ethical reasoning tell us what we ought to do. So science is very clear that the unborn, there are three things we want to show. The unborn are alive, they're human, and they're whole organisms. So how could we show that the unborn are alive? Well, one way we could do that is to say, look, if it's growing by cellular reproduction, it's got to be alive. That's just the common biological definition of life. There's also more grim ways we can show that. We can ask, if the unborn aren't alive, why do you need to even have an abortion at all? Now, that's the whole point. What does abortion do to the human embryo or human fetus? If it kills it, it had to have been alive at one point. But lots of things are alive. Snails are alive. Grass is alive. We kill living things all the time. So it's not just a living, it's human. How do we know the unborn are human? Two ways are helpful. One, you can look at DNA. Has human DNA approximately 46 chromosomes? Approximately. Some people have more, some people have less. But approximately 46 has human DNA. So it's biologically human. Or what are its parents? Two dogs make a dog, two cats make a cat, two humans make a human. But some people will say, well, look at my skin cells on my hand. They're alive and human. Am I killing human beings? No, because there's three parts. It's alive, it's human, and a whole organism. So what is a whole organism? A whole organism is an individual living thing capable of development. But how do we know that something is a organism and not just a body part like skin cells or sperm or egg? Well, I give it something I call the NET test, N-E-T, NET. Nutrition, environment, and time. If I can give it these three things, and it has the capacity to develop into a mature member of a species, it's an organism, right? So if I can give it food, the right environment, and enough time, can it become a mature member of a species? Whether it's a puppy, whether it's a bacterium, whether it's an oak sapling, or whether it's a human embryo. You give it the right environment, you give it food, you give it time. It might not always get to maturity. It could die naturally or at the hands of others, but it has that capacity to develop. But sperm, egg, cancer cells, skin cells, give them any nutrients, put them in any environment, give them unlimited time, you will always have sperm, egg, cancer cells, skin cells. The unborn, it's very clear. In fact, the very words you can ask people, all right, what is an embryo? What is a human embryo? What do the words embryo and fetus mean? Ask the person to define them. In relation to humans, it's a stage of development. Embryo is a human being from conception to the 7th week of life. Fetus is the 8th week of life until birth. There are stages of development in the life of a human being. Now, some people will say, well, okay, I'll give you that it's alive and it's human, it's biologically human, but it's not fully human. It's not a person. And so here, you can ask, well, what is a person? What does it mean to be fully human? And I think it's important for us to, sometimes at first, to make the other person defend their view, to put them in the hot seat, basically. Because if you're saying that the unborn is not a person, it's not fully human, then you need to know what fully human or person is. I'll stick with person. Just remember, when people say it's not human, you have to ask, do you mean biologically member of our species, or you mean a value judgment, doesn't have the same worth as the rest of us? Usually they mean this. So that's there, I think they really mean person. And now some pro-lifers get mad at me when I talk about personhood. They say, well, just talk about being human. Just talk about being human. Why do you bring person into this? Well, you need to bring person to this. I brought it into that with my debate with Nathan Nobis. You can watch on Monday. Because here's the thing. Some people will say, oh, what Nathan has argued and others argue is it can't just be about being human that matters. Because imagine Superman was real, not lame Superman from who directs the Henry Cavill movies? Zack Snyder. Yeah, he just quit after 300. It's Superman, not Mopey Man. It's terrible. Best depiction of Superman, there's an animated film, not, tell my wife, not a cartoon, it's an animated film called All-Star Superman. I think it's based on the Grant Morrison comics. Truly excellent. But that's my diversion there. All right, so is it wrong for Lex Luthor to kill Superman? Yeah, well, why? He's not human, he's Kryptonian. And so then what they'll say is, you know, oh, there's gotta be something else more than being human, you gotta be a person, okay? And you might say, well, that's silly, you know, Superman's a comic book character, but there could be persons that aren't human if aliens exist, or if you belong to many religious traditions, Christians believe angels exist, and angels are immaterial persons, but they're not human. So what is a person? So my definition of a person is an individual member of a rational kind. That makes sense to me. Being a person is not about what you can do, it's about what you are. You're an individual member of a rational kind. That would apply to every member of the humankind, or if we discovered other rational kinds, we would apply to them as well. It's about what you are, not what you can do. Most pro-choice definitions of a person are functional. That's why you should ask, if someone says the unborn are not persons, well, what is a person? And usually they'll say something like this. Well, anything that can think or feel, that is a person. Okay, well, how much? Then really drill down. How much do you have to think or feel to be a person? And the problem is, these functional definitions of personhood will fall into one of three errors. Number one, they'll set the bar way too low. They'll say, well, a person is something that can feel pain. But rats and pigeons can feel pain. Does that make them persons? In my debate with Nathan Nobis, Nathan is also a philosopher who defends animal rights. And he kind of basically bit the bullet, but he was very uncomfortable doing so, in saying, yeah, I guess rats, maybe they are persons. But think about that for a minute. Really think about it. Because, you know, what Nathan said is, I mean, think about it. Some people have rats as pets and they really love them. They're like persons to them. And I agree, if you killed somebody's pet rat, that would be very sad. Just like if somebody took a hammer to my vintage Super Nintendo that still works after 30 years. I have had that for 30 years, and it still works. And I would be in tears if someone broke it. But it's not a person, okay? So, and what I said is, you know, imagine that you had squatters living in your barn. And so you have a barn, you live in rural Virginia, you got a nice barn, you got squatters in there. Well, you go to the sheriff and you have to peaceful means to get rid of these people. What if I said, what if we just pumped it full of chlorine gas? That'll get rid of them one way or another. You can't do that. But then if rats were persons, we'd have to do the same thing. If you fumigated them, it would be murder. So if it's just pain that makes you a person, the bar is too low. If they say, well, it's not just pain, it's cognitive abilities beyond what a non-human animal can do. Problem is, that sets the bar too high. Then if you do that, no infant would be a person. No newborn infant would be a person under that definition. So it would exclude infants. So it's either too low or too high, or it's arbitrary. Well, it's a person is any biological human being that can feel pain. Okay, but why did you add biological human in there? And why do you have feeling pain? Because if feeling pain didn't give the right to life to a pigeon, it shouldn't give the right to life to a newborn. Like, it sounds like you're saying a person is human plus feeling pain, human plus being born. But that sounds very suspicious to me. Throughout human history, we've disqualified human beings from being persons by saying, ah, a person is human plus white, human plus male, human plus property owner. Why can't it just be human? Human plus is the source of oppression. The pro-life view is actually quite egalitarian, liberal-minded. It's saying we should expand the human community as widely as possible to include as many people as possible. It's inclusive. It believes in equality, equity even. We should make sure all people are given what they need to be considered fully human in the eyes of the law. Yet it doesn't catch on. It doesn't catch on with others. So I'm not sure why. Well, actually, I'll leave you with this thought. I do know why, and it kind of seeps into other issues that you guys will debate on campus or in the public sphere. And this is my thesis. When it comes to a controversial issue, when sex is involved, people lose their minds. I really believe that. Because think about it, when it comes to the issue of abortion, is it a human rights issue or is it a sexual ethics issue? I think it's kind of both. I really think that it's both. I think that if somehow we reproduced without sexual union, we just touch your finger to the genetic scanning pad and a baby grows in an artificial womb and people sought to kill children in those wombs, people would be outraged by that. But I'm telling you that when sex is involved in an issue, people just start to lose their minds. They can't think properly. For example, when a white person says that they are black and says, but I'm transracial, 99% of people ridicule that idea, right? We had Rachel Dolezal was that famous example several years ago. She became a leader in the NAACP even though she's actually white, but she could pass for black and she identified in that way even though she had white parents. And people say, oh, you can't, that's ridiculous. You can't, you know, just identify in that way. Transracial is a ridiculous thing. But transgender for many people is just something that is just so patently obvious. Those who disagree ought to be silenced because they're committing hate crimes in opposing this. But what's the difference? Well, one involves sexuality. And I think with abortion, people can't see it clearly because they see abortion. In fact, this was an argument for abortion in the Supreme Court case of Planned Parenthood versus Casey, the most famous Supreme Court case in the past 30 years until the more recent ones that are going to come out here in June. And it said in Planned Parenthood versus Casey that abortion needs to be legal because women have relied on contraception and abortion to have equal access to society. They've relied on abortion essentially as a backup form of birth control. And so I think many people, because here's the other thing that explains it to me. Why is this a sexual ethics issue? It's because I have never met someone who is naturally pro-choice under the age of 7 or 10. I'll pick 7, that's an easy one. When you show children under the age of 7 fetal models, they are in awe, and the thought of harming these individuals does not cross their minds. And if it does, it is a ghastly idea that they're repulsed by. Because under the age of 7, 8, 9, 10, then it starts to get dicey. But prior to puberty, prior to that awful, awful time, none of us ever want to go back to, I truly believe one of the worst things that we ever created in society was junior high. I really think it should just be you go to school until 5th grade, and then you're quarantined, and then you come back again in 9th grade. And we just skip over all of that. But before that, no thought. But then it's funny, a funny thing happens when I'm at the state fair at the pro-life booth, and I have the fetal models, and adults come, or teenagers come, and suddenly there's a lot of discomfort at looking at them. And I wonder why. Well, I don't have to wonder very hard. Because it's an issue that people have a vested interest in trying to argue against abortion because for many of them, they might see abortion as a kind of ultimate fallback contraceptive, for example. So I don't think that's necessarily the first point that we should raise in a dialogue, but I think it's something we have to keep in our minds to understand. Why can't people get this when it seems so obvious? Lots of things seem obvious, but when sex is involved, people can't think straight because they care more about, they're worried if I say that this sexual activity or this is wrong or that's wrong, what the walls will close in on the certain things that I value in this area of ethics. I truly believe, and that's why it's a hard uphill battle. But the way the other side will want to try to win. They win when we don't talk about it. They win when we don't talk about abortion because it sells itself to people who find themselves in unintended pregnancies. But when we talk about it, when we engage in fair and honest debate and dialogue, the pro-life position comes through in its intellectual, emotional, spiritual, its superiority in every sphere of human life. And so I would encourage you to take from this, read other books on this subject. I have a book, Persuasive Pro-Life. Chris Kazor has a great book, Ethics of Abortion, a pro-life philosophy book. And use this to sponsor debate, dialogue, even if it's not formal, even if it's just going out on campus with a sign, a poll table. Should abortion be legal, yes or no? People come and write their answer and then ask, I noticed you said it should be legal. Can I ask you a question? Do you think it should be legal through all 9 months for any reason? Well, maybe not all 9 months. And then you've got a plan to have a good conversation with someone on your campus. And I hope you'll do that. So thank you guys so much. And then can we do Q&A? Yes, that would be fun.
So students, if you would come up here and start a line and start with your name and your school. Thanks.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming, Mr. Horn. My name is Trent. I'm from Indianapolis, Indiana. I'm here with the Marion University YAF chapter. I had two questions. I wasn't really sure which one I was going to ask. It's either the traditional Latin Mass or Pope Francis and Joe Biden. Which one do you want?
I tell you what. Come on, man. I can't have all these questions here. Let's try Pope Francis. On traditional Latin Mass, my view is I am not a fan of newer liturgies that, you know, stray away from ancient tradition. So that's why my preference is the Eastern Divine Liturgy over the traditional Latin Mass.
Yeah, I've been going to a visiting Catholic liturgy for like 6 months now. It's the move, for sure.
Anyways, just joshing you. If it's valid, it's all good.
No,
but
yeah,
that's my personal preference.
No, yeah, for sure. So, you know, Pope Francis called out, and pray for Pope Francis. He's our Holy Father, all that jazz. Pope Francis called out Donald Trump for his slogan, build the wall, because to build walls is not what a Christian does. Obviously, Vatican City has had a wall since the 9th century. That goes besides the point. But however, when Joe Biden went to visit the Pope this fall, abortion never came up in conversation, even though in his presidency, Biden has been committed to promoting and funding abortion on demand in the United States and overseas. 75 Democratic Catholics, 75 Catholics who are Democrats in the House, none of them are pro-life. There's only one Democratic senator who is pro-life. Nancy Pelosi is a Catholic, but is not pro-life. Our church fathers weren't afraid to call out the BS when they saw it. Why is this not the case today?
Sometimes we don't get the shepherds that we want. We get the shepherds that the Holy Spirit thinks that we might need at this particular time and place. And that is just something, when you look, for example, not everyone here is Catholic, obviously, but Catholics believe that the Pope, you know, has the charism of infallibility when he speaks in very limited and narrow conditions. But in general, the graces of the Holy Spirit given to the Holy Father, given to the Pope, they only ensure that he will not formally bind the church to the wrong answer. They don't ensure that he will always have the conviction to give the right answer. That the Holy Spirit will sometimes allow the Pope to be silent when he ought to speak, rather than to let him speak when he should have been silent, especially in more formal conditions. So I find frustration there too. Pope Francis is just kind of an enigma. Sometimes I'm frustrated, sometimes he challenges me, and I appreciate that. But a lot of times he says things, I think we have to also concede, he'll say things that upset the apple cart for everybody. Like, I know so many liberals say, Pope Francis, he's the Pope that we really should admire, you know, liberal, even non-Catholics who are liberals say, oh, I love Pope Francis. And I say, oh, yeah, I love the time Pope Francis said abortion is like hiring a hitman. Do you agree with him? Well, you know, so that's why I think it can be helpful in these circumstances that when people say these things to point out, yeah, where the Holy Father has spoken forthrightly in a way that, yeah, I think that's great. And other times that I wish maybe he would say more. The thing with Donald Trump, I think that actually happened at a news conference. Yeah. That happened because I did a whole article about this, about the church's teaching on deportation. And the only time the magisterium, the only time on the Vatican website I could find references to deportation in a political context were twice, and it was when a reporter asked the Pope a question.
Yeah.
And he asked about this, and he kind of gave that off-the-cuff answer. Some of the off-the-cuff answers are great, others, eh. You know, so that's probably most I'll say there. But let's pray for our elected leaders. But by the way, also, I think what's very hard is that in modern politics, especially the Democratic Party, frankly, there's stringent purity tests that you get placed in. And it can happen very quickly. You go back 40, 50 years, there were a lot of pro-life Democrats. Jesse Jackson was pro-life. I think Ted Kennedy was pro-life. But then they get, and you even had Casey versus Planned Parenthood, the case that I referenced earlier. That's Bob Casey. He was the, I think it was Bob Casey at least. He was the governor of Pennsylvania at the time. And he was pro-life. And he was suing Planned Parenthood. So now he was a Democrat. But now it's, you know, there are these purity tests to say it's this or the highway. Similar to this issue of so-called same-sex marriage. That's one that strikes me. You go back in time 10 years, you had Hillary Clinton, Barack Obama in favor of traditional marriage. Now you can't be a Democrat unless that's your position. So I think also one of these difficult things is you have people who think, well, I agree with people on, I agree with this, but I also disagree with that, trying to find a political home. And I think anyone, regardless of what faith you are, whether you're Catholic, Protestant, Eastern Orthodox, you always have to put piety before party. I'm trying to think of another P word for religion. But you know, principles before party. That's what we always have to do. As soon as political party comes first and our religious convictions come second, regardless of where we are on the political spectrum, that's idolatry. Idolatry is when something else goes above God. It can happen, even in the political life. But thank you for your questions. That's helpful.
Thank you.
All right, thank you, Trent. My name is Will. I go to Bishop Ireton High School. That was a tough act to follow, so thank you for asking that question. My question's a bit different, and it has to do with one of the final points you made in your talk. A few new right thinkers proposed this idea of many of the modern socially liberal inventions, such as pornography, abortion, and other obsessions with sex, as comparable to forms of social control by economic elites, like the Marquis de Sade used this in the French Revolution, I believe. The French used cocaine to help mobilize Vietnam while they were stationed there during the colonization period. So my question
and
is...
And Coca-Cola to have a refreshing drink.
That too.
They
that
did,
too.
Yeah. Not anymore, but all right, okay.
But yeah, my question is, do you think this kind of analysis of sex-related movements as forms of social control comparable to many that have been used throughout the centuries is, do you think it's beneficial or do you think it's more conspiratorial minded and based on like bogus science that a lot of new thinkers have proposed?
I'm not sure how to answer the question because it's asking sort of a broad view. I'd have to have a little bit more about what you mean by sex as social control. Whether it's done in a formal way through government bureaucracy or legislation, I'm not sure. Yeah, I guess I need to know more, a little more. What do you mean by the phrase sex as social control? Could you just tease that a little?
Sure. So what I mean is it's this psychological factor where it sort of creates an obsession with, this obsession with sex prevents you from focusing on other issues, other things you would necessarily oppose if you were, like, if your mind was free from constraints, sort of, similar to how the French.
Yeah, I think then my response might be this. I like this thing called Heinlein's razor, and it's a way of approaching issues that goes like this. Never attribute to malice what can be attributed to stupidity. And I think this is helpful when we engage others who disagree with us. I always try to assume a person is ill-informed or misinformed before they're malicious. And so It would take a lot of evidence for me to say that there is some kind of formal program to use sexual issues to confuse people. I would need a lot of evidence for that, because my default would just be that human nature tends towards something we call concupiscence, towards just a natural desire for things of the flesh, for things that aren't good for us. And so that natural desire in and of itself is quite capable of distorting our rational thinking on its own without a cabal of elites needing to organize it. So while I won't rule out that possibility, I would need a significant amount of evidence to move me away from the, just that this is just the natural plight of human beings. What philosophers of religion call the noetic effects of sin, but I like to calling the thesis that sin makes you stupid. So is that helpful?
No, that's very helpful. Thank you so much.
Okay, sure. Has anyone ever told you guys you're smart? So you're here. Obviously, you're smart. You're YAF. But these are great. Let's keep it rolling. Go right ahead.
Hi. So my name is Gabrielle. I'm from Catholic University. And something I've noticed over the years is that when pro-life advocates are battling with the Roe v. Wade, and there is concern among pro-death and abortion advocates for overturning Roe v. Wade and what that's going to look like, I've noticed there seems to be a cop-out argument of it'll just return to the states. There's not a pressing issue for the other side. What is the most valuable response to that?
What do you mean by the phrase a cop-out argument when you say people say that if Roe versus Wade were overturned, it will just go back to the states? What do you mean by that being a cop-out argument?
When I say cop-out, I'm referring to it's not hitting the core issue of abortion is immoral, period.
Sure. Who do you think is doing the cop-out?
Students on campus.
Like ones who are pro-life or pro-choice?
Pro-life.
I see. That they don't think there's that much of an urgency to the issue?
Yes.
Because it'll just go back to the states? Well, I think that what they failed to grasp is that if they're pro-life, that returning the issue to state governments to legislate is a necessary condition, but not necessarily a sufficient one. There will be 50 fights, so to speak, about how abortion will be regulated in those states. I think, and I don't know if this is where you're tracking, like ideally, I would want some kind of constitutional amendment or something to protect unborn children at a federal level. Like, I think that is the ideal that pro-lifers would want. But it's okay to disagree in the pro-life sphere. This is also important. We can't be fighting each other over things that are secondary. We are allowed to have prudential judgments or disagreements. Some people say, hey, we should go for broke, constitutional amendment. Others will say, we don't have the political capital for that. Let's go state by state to work at this, maybe hit that later. But I agree with you that regardless of the approach that's taken, there's no easy silver bullet. It's going to be a long, arduous fight ahead. And regardless of what path you think is most prudent, those who will try to sit back and say, oh, it's not that big a deal, are just kind of kidding themselves. So is that a helpful answer?
Yes. Thank you.
Okay, great.
Hi, my name is Sam, and I am homeschooled under Mother Divine Grace Umbrella School. And my question is, say I'm in an argument with someone and you brought up the point, like the high standard of cognitive abilities, and that person agrees that cognitive abilities is what defines the person and whether they should be allowed to be alive or not through abortion.
Sure.
And they say, children that are born like newborns, so they can be, they should be allowed to be murdered because they don't have cognitive abilities.
Mm.
So how would you proceed with that argument? Would you go down the lines of like someone who's unconscious, like in a coma? Or like how would you proceed with that?
Yeah, so this is someone, the toughest pro-choice position to refute is the one that is willing to bite the bullet on infanticide. This would be Peter Singer's position. Michael Tooley, there was the Oxford Journal of Medicine several years ago published a defense of infanticide. And so it's difficult if someone just bites the bullet and says, yeah, I think a person is anyone who can think rationally. So human fetuses are not persons, human newborns are not persons. And so there, I think to combat infanticide arguments, you can make different, there's a few different paths you can take. One, you could just take the blunt moral intuition path to say, well, I just think we shouldn't kill babies. What's wrong with that? It just seems clear to me that killing babies, raping anyone, women, raping people, killing babies, I just know it's wrong. Just like I know that the external world is real, the past actually happened, why should I reject that view? Can you give me a reason? Why should I? It's just so obvious to me killing babies is wrong. Why should I be persuaded by your philosophical argument otherwise? So that would be the blunt moral intuition path that you could take. Other paths you could take is to try to critique their view of personhood, to say, all right, well, what is a person? And say, oh, you know, well, a person is, you know, they'll try to maybe try to say things like, you know, it's just a collection of thoughts. You know, you're a mental state. And then I might say, okay, try to poke holes in that view. So I guess I might say, all right, so if I'm just a collection of thoughts, and under this view, which is a strange view, I am not a body. I am a collection of thoughts that controls a body. So that already gets kind of weird. Like, I don't kiss my wife goodbye when I go on a trip. I pilot my body to kiss my wife goodbye, which is not how most people view what we are. But even then, when I go to sleep, and I'm in a deep sleep, and I'm not dreaming, I would ask the question, where am I? Like, it would seem to me that I occupy space. Where am I? But you can't find my collection of thoughts in my inactive, you know, my brain and its REM cycle. Where am I? Do I stop existing? Do I come back when I wake up? Am I no longer a person when I'm in a deep sleep? And they'll say, well, you're still a person because, you know, you'll wake up and you can have rational thoughts. Okay, what if I'm in a coma? And we don't know if it's reversible or irreversible. We're not sure yet. Am I still a person? Because I think many of the people you engage would say that if I was in an irreversible coma, they would say, oh yeah, you're not a person anymore. But what if we don't know? Then it becomes, we don't really know if you're a person right now. Why would we give you medical treatment if we're not even sure you're a person? But it all seems very strange that it hinges on further future facts or issues about whether I'm a mind or not. And actually, I cover a lot of this in my debate with Nobis, if you want to check that out, because I critique this view as well. Because one of my arguments in that debate against abortion was the identity argument. And the identity argument goes, so this is more philosophical stuff. It goes like this. Here's the identity argument. If an organism doesn't die, it still exists. All right? I'm an organism. So I must be the same organism that was in my mother's womb. All right? That organism never died, so it must still exist. I'm that organism. If it's wrong to kill me now, it was wrong to kill me then. And what's true about killing me is true about others, so it's wrong to kill anybody in the womb because I am a human organism. And then I discuss the view that I'm not just a collection of thoughts in the debate itself. But anyway, is that helpful?
Yes, thank you so much.
Sure. Right ahead.
Hi, Trent. My name's Nick. I'm a student at St. Louis University. So last semester, more than 300 professors and administrators pressured the pastor of the Catholic Church on campus to cancel our pro-life lecture by Matt Walsh. And that was done with less than 24 hours of notice. We had to scramble to find a new venue. And then early in the semester, students destroyed our Cemetery of the Innocents display. And they only got a slap on the wrist after YAF helped bring a ton of attention to it and public pressure there. So last month, the campus ministry and the social action departments of SLU brought in a pro-choice, genderless, kinky, sex-positive pastor to give a lecture. So my question is, where do you think we should draw the line between freedom of speech and Catholic values, if any, on a Catholic college campus?
I think Catholic colleges should be Catholic.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a crazy idea for you. Especially with all the money people spend to go there.
Yeah.
You'd think that they should be. Yeah, I've thought about this. Well, ideally, Catholic universities are the hardest universities for me to be able to go and speak at, to be able to host events. It's sad what has happened. And so how should we respond? First, I would say You should not take, you know, unethical, immoral, even illegal responses to your clubs on these campuses as just a defeat. Mm-hmm. Like, let's say you're going to set up an innocence. Because think of it this way. Let's say you're going to set up a display, Cemetery of the Innocents for the Unborn, okay? And people come and tear it down. I think, honestly, if you're going to do events like this and you are on a very hostile campus, mm-hmm. you should plan to have someone always present to record
yep.
these events. Because really, the key, like when I went to debate Nathan at Emory, like when I go and do debates or I do public events at college campuses, because travel's hard, I have little kids, I make sure that there's video footage of it. Mm-hmm. Because it's great to help the 100 people who come to show up to the event, whoever it may be. But if you can take that those images and put them online for tens of thousands or millions of people to see, then you're not defeated if you make a Cemetery of the Innocents that intolerant pro-choice people tear up. If anything, you have achieved a victory. If you have recorded this happening and then you can put it online, you've achieved a victory in exposing that one side of a contentious issue wants to have fair-minded debate and another side uses violence to get what they want. Because here's the thing, what you have to remember, and everyone here needs to remember, Twitter is not real life. Twitter is not real life. I actually barely tweet anymore because it's a black hole, and I think only 2% of the US population uses Twitter frequently. But many people on university campuses, it's like universities and Twitter, they think, oh, that's the world. It's not. Now, you might think that because in your colleges or on Twitter, everyone you meet is this rabid, vocal, pro-choice advocate. Mm-hmm. Most people are independent or they're ambivalent. They don't like abortion. They maybe think it's murder, but I don't want to say anything. The people that I want to engage with my arguments are not the rabid left. The people I want to engage are the mushy middle. That's who I want to reach. And there aren't a lot of them on college campuses, at least ones you'll talk to. But if you can record the rabid left being intolerant or violent, and you are just taking it on the chin with grace, then the mushy middle says, I don't want to be like those guys. But what are these guys saying? So I think that's the key there. Because that's what I thought is like, look, like when people go to shout down Matt Walsh or Ben Shapiro and Trent Horn, that doesn't happen. But we came close at Drew University. They were actually quite civil. I enjoyed that. I've thought, like, maybe you should just go and shout down this pro-choice kinky person, whoever. Or it's, I don't know if person is a gendered term or is individual. I don't know. They could be non-binary. I don't know. Whatever. It. Shouting down it. It's like, because that's what they do to us. It's like, oh, maybe we should just do that and stand up. Like, no, we have to resist the temptation. We, to show that we can take things with grace and conviction. And I think saying I would like to have, like, having a table outside of the event to dialogue with people, saying I disagree with a big sign, mm-hmm. saying that, saying let's have a dialogue. And if you can record people being intolerant in response to you, that it's about capturing the fact that the left many times shouts it down, doesn't want to debate, uses underhanded tactics. We do not do that, and we should strive to not do that. And then show the mushy middle what's really happening. I think that's the key that we really need to focus on as we put our message out there to reach them. So is that helpful?
Yeah, thank you very much.
Okay, great. I think we have to go to a break here in a sec, so maybe I think I'll have to make this the last question. But I will be available up through lunch if you guys have other questions or people are hanging out. So I'll be around. So go right ahead.
All right. Hi, Trent. I'm Samantha. I'm from Marion University in Indianapolis. Thank you for coming today. So my question kind of stems off of IVF and like how after that's done, that's usually the reproduction of several embryos.
Right.
And that like, so, you know, not all of them, of course, are implanted for this couple that are wanting to have children. So, obviously, there's thousands or possibly millions of embryos living in labs
yeah.
in the world. So, what do you think is the best way to go about, like, how, like, what we should do with all of those embryos? Because some of them are freezed off or killed, and obviously that's immoral.
Yeah, right. So, this is the question with IVF, many times surplus embryos are created. What should be done about those children? These are children at a very young age of development. First, when it comes to the immorality of in vitro fertilization, a new book on the subject out by my friend Stephanie Gray Connors. It's called Conceived by Science. Highly recommended if you want to learn about IVF and moral arguments against IVF, because some pro-life advocates will say, well, I'm not opposed to IVF if we only create one embryo and implant that child. I'm against killing extra embryos, not creating one. Stephanie's book is good on that. I would recommend Conceived by Science by Stephanie Gray Connors. But then what is the moral route to take with what are called snowflake babies or snowflake adoption? You have embryos cryopreserved, abandoned by their parents. What do we do with them? And in the Catholic Church, at least, there are two options that are debated. The magisterium has left it an open question. Should we leave the embryos, or should we allow people to adopt them? Is it one side says we should do what's best for the children's well-being, and so we could have we could have married couples or others adopting these children for the child's sake, not just because they're infertile, but because they want to rescue the child. Another argument is, well, no, that would still be immoral, because you would have lab technicians causing women to become pregnant rather than their husbands. It's still disordered in that regard, so there's just no way to help these children. It's a bit of an open question, and I will be honest that I do not have a principled answer to the question at this time. I'm actually editing an anthology with the National Catholic Bioethics Center on human embryo adoption. We'll have like 50 articles in it, so I'm one of the co-editors of the volume. It already exists. We're re-releasing a second edition of it. So I have to go through, I'm gonna go through actually all of that, and I'm arranging the articles and the prefaces, and I still haven't made up my mind, principally, which side is right or wrong on that. Honestly though, I do have a pragmatic argument. My pragmatic argument is that if you promote embryo adoption, it will result in the creation of more abandoned embryos. And so even if it were moral in principle, I worry that practically it will lead to negative results. And so I lean on towards a pragmatic argument against promoting that, but principally I am in the middle between which view is right or wrong. So that's how I would answer. And hopefully I'll resolve that once we've published the second edition of the anthology. So is that helpful?
Yes, it is. Thank you so much.
Sure. All right. As I said, I'll be hanging around a bit. If you guys want more, my book is Persuasive Pro-Life. I'm actually hoping to release a second edition of that book, hopefully by next January. So we will, especially because things are changing, we'll see what happens in June. So check that out and other great resources at our website, my podcast, The Council of Trent, definitely check that out. And I'll turn back to our hosts. Thank you all. And I'll be here through lunch.